Hello, B here, and welcome back to Environmental Science. Wow, I was so thirsty. I had to get a drink of water. Where do you think this water comes from? We've just finished learning about the water cycle and saw that it evaporates and travels into the atmosphere as water vapor before condensing to fall as precipitation again. Much of this water will eventually end up back in the ocean. So is that where the water in my glass came from? Ew, I hope not. That water would be salty and not refreshing at all. We'll need to find some non-salty sources of water as we go through our lesson today. So let's start exploring. Freshwater systems are made of water that is not salty, which is the type of water we want to drink. Can you think of any sources of freshwater? Pause the video for a moment and brainstorm a list in your notes. Did you include lakes as a freshwater system on your list? Lakes are some of the largest reservoirs of freshwater on Earth. But scientifically, what is a lake? Is a pond a lake? Do the oceans count as lakes? Let's start with some examples of water that are not lakes. Pay close attention to the movement of the water. What do you notice in both of these cases? Now look at some examples that are lakes. What's different about these? The lakes contain still water and have no significant or permanent current. Of course, you may sometimes see a small current or waves in lakes, but these are driven by the wind and change with its direction. But there's one more rule a body of water must follow to be a lake. See if you can tell what the rule is by looking at these two examples. Why does one show a lake while the other does not? Lakes must be surrounded on all sides by land. The oceans don't meet either of our rules, so we can safely say that the oceans are not lakes. But we also know that the oceans contain salt water. Does that mean that lakes can't have salt water? Not quite. While most lakes contain fresh water, there are a few exceptions, such as the Great Salt Lake in Utah and the Dead Sea between Jordan and Israel. Based on our defining characteristics, do you think that ponds count as lakes? They are surrounded by land and have no current. You might be surprised to learn that scientifically, there is no clear distinction between ponds and lakes. We generally call smaller bodies of water ponds and larger bodies lakes, but ultimately, it's a subjective decision. Let's move on to another type of freshwater system by taking a quick flight over Niagara Falls. What do you think feeds this majestic waterfall? That's right, a river. Unlike lakes, rivers do have a permanent current. And in the case of the Niagara River, that current causes the water to continuously plummet over a cliff, making a waterfall. Rivers are flowing bodies of water that move continuously in one direction, usually toward a lake, sea, or ocean. They are crucial for transporting nutrients and sediments across long distances. Some rivers can be quite large, such as the Amazon River in South America, which is over 4,000 miles long and supports the rich biodiversity of the Amazon rainforest. On the other extreme, many rivers are quite small and considered to be streams, especially if they flow into other larger rivers before reaching more stable bodies of water, such as lakes or oceans. Did you know that we've already explored another type of freshwater system in our last lesson? Can you guess what it is? I'll give you a hint. Remember the hot, muggy swamp of the Florida Everglades? This is an example of a wetland. Why do you think that a wetland such as this swamp is classified differently than a lake or river? In wetlands, water covers the soil for part of the year, but the depth and coverage varies too much between seasons to create a stable, distinct shoreline that we expect of a lake. Wetlands are incredibly rich in biodiversity and serve as breeding grounds for many species. They act like natural sponges, absorbing excess water and reducing flooding in nearby habitats. In the lesson activities, you'll explore the three main types of wetlands: swamps, marshes, and bogs, and learn how they are all critical to the functioning of ecosystems. So, how does water from precipitation end up in lakes, rivers, and wetlands? Sure, some of it might fall directly in, but a lot of it falls on the ground instead. Do you think it will ever end up back in the ocean? Or are there other possible futures it may experience? When rain hits the ground, it doesn't just stay in one place. Gravity pulls water downhill, leading it to flow over the land as surface runoff. This surface runoff is one of the primary ways water collects in rivers, wetlands, and lakes, the key components of our freshwater systems. As water travels over the ground and through these systems, it picks up nutrients, sediments, and sometimes pollutants, carrying them downstream. However, not all water from precipitation stays on the surface. Some of it infiltrates the ground, replenishing groundwater reserves. Groundwater is stored in aquifers, underground layers of water-bearing rock. From here, it eventually finds its way back to the surface, emerging in springs or seeping into rivers, lakes, and wetlands, continuing the cycle. In this way, freshwater systems are interconnected, forming a vast network that continually moves and recycles water. Eventually, many rivers carry water all the way to the ocean. Once there, the water could stay for a while, evaporate back into the atmosphere, or contribute to cloud formation, which leads to... you got it, precipitation. And thus, the water cycle starts anew, creating endless possibilities for every water drop. So, in our water drop's immediate future, the possibilities for its next destination are nearly endless. Over long periods of time, it is likely that this water drop will experience many of these possible homes, though none will be permanent. But why is learning about Earth's freshwater systems important in the first place? Let's take a quick trip to a wetland ecosystem in the Middle East, the Mesopotamian marshes, and go back in time just a bit to the 1990s. These areas were biodiversity hotspots, supporting a wide variety of life, such as fish, amphibians, birds, and mammals. However, during this time, the local government built several large dams upstream of the marsh on the Tigris and Euphrates rivers. These dams were intended to divert water away from the marshes to provide water for irrigation, hydroelectric power, and flood control in nearby upstream areas. In addition, much of the wetland was intentionally drained to make room for agricultural fields. What impact do you think this had on the region? Do you think this was good for the local economy? What about the environmental impacts and functioning of the ecosystem? Pause the video for a moment and brainstorm some possible consequences for this decision. While some of the region enjoyed an uptick in job growth and productivity due to the newly available land and energy resources, other regions felt the economic sting of a fishing industry that quite literally dried up. Some farmers found their fields suddenly flooded beyond use and the soil's fertility destroyed, and the environmental impacts were far-reaching. With the marsh dried up, the ecosystem collapsed, unable to support its rich diversity of life and many birds, fish, and otters were driven to near extinction. Some efforts are now being made to redirect water and restore the marshes, but with so much damage done, it is unlikely that they will fully recover. This is a powerful lesson of how manipulating our hydrosphere for short-term gain can have devastating long-term consequences. As we went through the lesson today, we saw how Earth's freshwater systems include lakes, rivers, and wetlands. Because the water cycle moves through the hydrosphere, water is continuously transported through these different systems, supporting various ecosystems as it goes. We also saw how freshwater systems support a delicate balance of life in ecosystems on Earth, and disrupting our freshwater systems can cause a major collapse. Next time, we'll take a deeper dive into one of the largest freshwater systems, lakes. Until then, remember, keep turning your ripples into waves. Dive in, stay curious, and keep learning. I'll see you next time. Hey.